And we should be live, everybody. Hello, welcome to the Weird Developers live session this week on the 6th of May. Very happy to welcome everybody here. We have around 30 people right now, so very excited to have you all coming in and joining the event. My name is Vilana. I'm the community program manager of Weird Developers and the one who brings the webinars to you every week. And before we start, a couple of house rules. Please say hello immediately in the chat section on the right side so we can warm up the environment. It's a bit weird when we're just talking to our screen. So all your hellos, tell us where you're from, tell us what you do. It's very encouraging for us to know that you're actually hearing us and listening and have you engaged the whole time. As you can see on top of the chat, there is a bit of a disclaimer. It's about our code of conduct. So every online event also complies with our code of conduct. So please be inclusive and respect each other in the chat sections. And last but not least, ask questions. Florian is here to give us a really interactive session today. So ask questions throughout the whole presentation and also at the end. And he'll be either looking them throughout the session or we will also take questions at the end. So stay engaged in the Q&A section also on the right side next to the chat. And yeah, for the ones who don't know what Weird Developers is or what do? We actually have a job platform for developers and we're building one of the biggest communities in Europe for developers. So usually we have our events. This year we had to postpone them, obviously, but we are still want to engage you live with this. Super excited for the session today because Florian is a dear friend of mine and we know each other since 2013, I think. So it's very nice to have him here and now working professionally together. It's awesome to share the stage with him. He actually has a background in software and networking and currently is a developer advocate at Cisco DevNet with a focus on IoT. And today he'll tell us about edge computing, how to do it to your network. So I'm going to mute myself and turn off my camera. Florian, the stage is yours. And yeah, I'll be back if something is needed. So everybody enjoy.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Viliana, for these nice words and nice introduction there. Hello from home this time. I hope everybody is doing right and is excited also about this topic. As much as I am, of course, I would like to share now my screen here and then you can already see what we are up to. All right. So basically, you should see my screen now a bit. I am Florian Pachinger. Somebody call me Flo. I'm a developer advocate at Cisco DevNet. And today I would like to talk about edge computing done by your network. So what does it mean? And so on. So I will go slowly into this topic there. But first of all, I would definitely think it would be good to know from your side, who am I? Like, who is talking here under these circumstances? So that you have a bit of a background. So Viliana told a bit about me as well. So I'm actually based in Frankfurt in Germany. I have a software and networking background there. So basically started with Cisco in 2016 and did all my Cisco certifications there. And before that, I was working a lot with software and studied it like bachelor's and master's degrees there. Since 2017, since also in the beginning there, I really focused on lots of IoT projects. What we are calling IoT. So basically a lot of connecting things together, connecting people, connecting processes together. And it was really fun because I was part of some really cool IoT projects, what we did in Germany and where we definitely connected, especially with the focus on the manufacturing industry, a lot of things, a lot of devices where you can imagine there. One thing that I would really like to make it as interactive as possible. So if you have any questions, please ask them right away in the chat. unfortunately, right now I can't see in the button when I'm sharing the your text immediately. However, I will sometimes check there. Also, I will share my screen, show us a nice demo. So basically, please ask right away. I will try them to answer it right away, or with a bit of delay. However, I would like to make this as interactive, of course, as possible, and so that you won't get bored, basically. So I really would like to focus a lot on the content there. And yeah, this is basically, I really like to start as well with a question. So what is edge computing to you? And please write it in the chat. I would really like to know what you think about edge computing. It doesn't need to be like a lot, just maybe some words, one, two sentences. Would be really cool to get your input there. What do you think is edge computing, or what do you relate, or what word? This would be really cool. I will check now the answers as well, what we have in the chat window there. So just, yeah, type. So what is edge computing to you? This would be the question. What would be the interaction? What would be, what does it mean there? Or what can you relate there? It can also be one word. It can also be something else, but this would be really nice to get a feeling there. What comes to your mind there? Yeah, exactly. Close or low latency compute, something like that. Exactly. I would say this is very good. So this is exactly what I see some other tipping. I will leave it a bit open. So basically, this is definitely true. Close low latency compute. This is definitely something what's very interesting, or what's basically what edge computing is there about. So I will just go forward here and see what is the definition by Gartner, which I think this is really interesting. And where edge computing is described really good. So edge computing is basically a part of a distributed computing topology, where information processing is located close to the edge, and where things and people produce or consume that information. And maybe some of you find this boring and saying, okay, this is totally basics. Some of you, maybe this is kind of new, but I would like to start from the bottom here and saying it is a distributed computing technology. It's close to the edge, hence the edge there. And there are things and people who produce or consume this information there. And I will start, like, as you can see here, this is a basic definition there. And now I would really like to go further now and go into what is kind of there, because edge computing is such a big paradigm. So I will definitely go more into the details and into the different categories there are. Before that, I think this is maybe also, since edge computing has it around there since a couple of years now already, why is edge computing so important? Or why is it here? So basically, it's mostly about safety, or the fast response time, and also together with the latency, do I get a fast latency there? This is especially for some computing paradigm, or for some scenarios, very, very important, especially when you need the answer right away. So with a couple of milliseconds, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 milliseconds. Then, of course, data protection. So we have now the data which is at the edge, which stays there, which won't be sent to the cloud or to any other data center, which is leaving, like, or geographically on-prem, which is definitely on-premise there. And this is sometimes required, for example, in utilities company, where the data needs to be there. The data does not, like, it's not allowed by law, actually, that the data will actually be transferred to any cloud, for example. Another thing is bandwidth. So we have a lot of course, the advantages there when it comes to bandwidth, that we don't need to send a lot of data to the cloud. So it will basically stay where it is, or like it will be aggregated at the edge. It will already pre-computed, pre-processed basically at the edge. And from there, only the important data will go to the end destination, to the data lake. Another scenario why edge computing or another reason is always on connectivity. So basically, it is always on. So when you need a connectivity, when your client, your sensor is not capable of caching or in the end saving the data right away when they need it. So that a caching capability is right at the edge there. And if there is no cloud connectivity, you will save your data, for example, at the edge. You still can serve clients, or clients can still connect at the edge. And if there is, again, a cloud connectivity there, this the edge broker, the edge device, the IoT gateway is actually sending then this data to the cloud. Another part is connecting heterogeneous systems. So this is basically about you have lots and lots of different protocols at the edge there. So we have it really similar with MQTT or AMQP, which is basically in the cloud, or which where a lot of devices and a lot of SDKs and software stacks are in the end supporting MQTT. But below there, we have a lot of heterogeneous systems, a lot of different protocols, especially in the manufacturing, but then also, of course, in utilities, in the transformation, in the transportation areas. So, of course, we are going more and more, this is what I see, into a standardization where a lot of protocols are getting together, for example, OPCOA, but still we have these heterogeneous protocol systems where they need to be connected there. And this is why edge computing, or at least some stack at the edge, make a lot of sense here. Also, when we see all of this, and then I will definitely go to the various categories, is still where does this edge computing come from, or where was the need there? So when we go back, actually, think about this one. We are in the 15 or in the 60s, we have single terminal PCs which are connected to the mainframes there. So the computing power, or like where data was processed, was mostly the mainframes. When we look starting at the 70s, so with Apple II in 1977, for example, desktop PCs came more and more relevant. So the mainframes, the computing power, was basically like still there. However, it got more distributed. Why? Because the desktop computers, of course, they got more powerful. So they got smaller, the computing power got smaller, more powerful, and so it moved to the desktops there. If you think nowadays, or starting from the 2000s on, this is basically a lot of the cloud is there. So cloud was starting with 2006 in Amazon with the Elastic Cloud, it was introduced there. The cloud came more and more popular. Everybody wanted to have connect to the cloud. Let's do the computing in the cloud. Let's do everything in the cloud there. And now it depends, and this is what you will hear definitely a lot. It depends on the use case. Now the edge is getting more and more important. Because as you can see, especially when it comes to the video streaming, when it comes to also mobile gaming, for example, or in the end, artificial intelligence or the machine learning paradigms, you will see that the edge is getting also more and more important. The cloud will stay. The edge is just complementary to the cloud. So basically, we won't see everything is shifting to all these Internet of Things or IoT devices, but the cloud will still be there. However, the edge will be there in order to what I just saw, read before, what I just presented you before about the different scenarios where edge computing makes a lot of sense. And this is basically what's the next slide about, with a bit of a nice visualization of this traditional approach there. So you have here the things down there which are basically directly connected to the data lake. This would be the traditional approach to take the data to the processing there. And now this is the optimal approach, or this is where definitely it makes sense, where a lot of use cases to use this approach here, that you have the things here connected and you want to send, or you want to compute these things there before sending it to the data lake, or before sending it to your private cloud, before sending it to your public cloud. And this is where all of these paradigms, what is written here, is coming in. So there is edge computing, then also Cisco, we said also a lot about fog computing in 2012. There was content delivery networks, so they were even before this was kind of the first approach of getting compute power actually to the edge. There is cloudlets, ubiquitous computing. So you can see here, these paradigms basically, these mean similar things. They mean to have a distributed or to have something between the device, between the things, between the sensors and the end destination. So it's mostly about, of course, sending the data from the things to the data lake. However, it's not always about it. So it's all definitely about connecting those things together. It's connecting about different, like having a low latency, having somewhere in the middle of the data process from the things to the data lake. And this is where I would like to say, when you see here the different paradigms, it's a very big paradigm. And now let's try to slice it. Let's try to slice these the term edge computing, and let's see what is actually there, what kind of hardware or what kind of software actually. So here is the perspective of from basically from a network. So we have here seven pillars or seven categories there, where also different vendors or different companies are calling in a way edge compute, but they mean sometimes not the same, or they mean basically something very different. And this is what it's definitely good to clarify here. So at first, in this the first pillar, we have the end devices, the things. So here is basically the sensor makers or the manufacturers of the sensoring on end devices there. Then we have the appliance vendors, so who are creating IoT appliances, classic IoT gateways there. For example, from a proprietary protocol or LoRaWAN. Then we have the network vendors. This is basically where Cisco is in with routers and gateways. They are connecting the network connectivity and the compute, the edge compute. And then the other categories here, the cell towers, so service providers, edge compute. So basically to put the compute power close to the cell tower. And I will come to this later, why this is so important here. And then on the other side, we have also edge compute from service providers, or basically also from vendors who are having or who see edge compute as a data center appliance, or like basically as a data center as the edge. So as you can see here, the industry is saying this is basically the edge. This is the whole pillar, what the edge is. However, here we have, as I said, with the smarter things there, the service provider edge in order to define it a bit more. And then basically, however you call it, but the true edge or this outer edge or this far edge, this is basically here with the IoT appliance and with the routers and with the gateways. And we definitely check it, or like we'll go more into details here about what are here the different devices there and what is the software about, what is the hardware about. So I will definitely go into more of the slices there. In terms of distance, like response time, you can see here what does it mean there. So basically, the end device and the things are very, very close to the data generating device. So we have here 1 microsecond. And here, when it comes to IoT appliance or router gateways, about the true edge, this is basically our definition here. It needs to have at least 1 millisecond where you have the response time there. And then, of course, as usual, depending on the hardware and the software, however, this is basically from a cell tower to a region data center, 5 to 20 milliseconds, 10 to 50 milliseconds, and then to the cloud, 20 to 30 milliseconds. Or for example, like it can go, of course, even further, like two seconds even sometimes. Before I go more deeper into this one, I will just check shortly about the questions, if there are any so far. Perfect. Yes, I will. Does it have any connection with 5G network? I will come to this one right away. So perfect. Thanks for this question. If you have any questions, like I said, or you just joined earlier, definitely write your questions in the chat there. Make it as interactive as possible there. So here we have the seven pillars, basically, or seven categories there. And now let's go even further and go to the hardware view. And the hardware view is like this. So let's start from the left side here and see here end devices and things. So this is basically sensors and devices. With edge computing, of course, or like, as I said, with the cloudlets and with everything, with the old paradigms, a sensor is, it can be a like the sensing port from the Raspberry Pi sensor. It can be any temperature sensor. But also from devices, it can be actually as well smartphones. It can be sensors on the smartphones. So this is basically a very broad overview what you have there. It can be in the industrial world, for example, it can be I/O, input-output devices there, where they're sensing in nearly near real time, so a couple of milliseconds, sensing, for example, the light, sensing if there is anybody coming to the machine, if there is any temperature raise, for example, if there is, for example, a how is it called, a threshold in the temperature. So this is basically all about sensing. It can be ruggedized, it can be embedded, so you can have these sensors on the machine. You can have the sensors directly on the truck, on a truck, on a car, for example. So this is more about sensing and sending the data further, or like forwarding this data. Then let's go to IoT appliances and routers and gateways, like to have this in they're basically different categories. The main difference is that IoT appliances are really solely for the IoT, for the IoT protocols, or for IoT data analytics, and routers and gateways more broad, or is going more into this network hardware direction. But they are basically very similar. So basically, we have a small or smaller form factor. They can be ruggedized or even embedded. So just with the with a platine card or with a normal card there, and then we have as well a classic x86 CPU or ARM platform. So I wrote there here Atom CPU, so just that you can somehow see that it won't be like Xeon CPU. It can be an i3 from Intel, for example, or like depends, of course, on the hardware and the ruggedization. But however, we have here usually a low-powered x86 CPU and the ARM CPU. And then, of course, a couple of gigabyte of RAM for the application, sometimes a bit less, sometimes a bit more. And then, of course, always coming, this is basically the trend, GPUs. So we have already GPUs already in those appliances there. This depends a lot on of the use case. So with machine learning, but I would say it's a lot with image processing or with video image processing. So basically where an IP camera, they have already some GPUs on there or integrated graphics processing units there, where you can immediately like recognize like this is a person, this is basically someone who is trying to steal you something. So this is basically all already integrated in those IoT appliances and in some IoT gateways and routers. However, it's still like not there yet, not there that common, but it's coming up more and more. With routers and gateways, you have also various interfaces there. So like with LTE, serial, or WAN, but this is basically the gateway to the cellular network or to the internet, to the via Ethernet. When we go now to the cell tower, so cell tower, hardware view only, you have the classic rack or blade servers. So you don't have any small form factor there. Of course, you can have smaller rack and blade servers. Of course, they can be ruggedized, but usually in the usual view is basically that it's a powerful a data center there, or powerful edge data center, edge appliance there with Xeon x86 CPUs, There can be also GPUs in there, so this is also possible. On the other side, not that different, a regional data center, also with Record Blade servers, Xeon x86 CPUs, and there could be also GPUs there. Just one thing, so here, so this is basically only the hardware view. We will go now more to the software view to see what software is running on it and what are basically a bit of the use cases there. But however, one thing is also there is that we have here on the left side the end customer, and usually the end customer is basically owning those devices or are responsible for these devices. Sometimes they are buying in with managed service, for example, the management of those tools or like of this hardware. However, the end customer is usually the manager or like is responsible to get IoT appliances started, to get the send devices, the things started, and to get on the network or the connectivity to the internet. This is part of the end customer and the managed service. On the other hand, we have here, and this is where the wide area network WAN is coming in, we have here the service provider. So service provider who is owning basically the hardware of next to the cell tower, for example. Also, of course, in the regional data center. However, also the customer can, of course, with a private cloud, for example, host all of this in their own data center. So we can go here fully on-prem, or we can go here, of course, in a hybrid solution where the data or the connectivity will be through the cloud or will be through the on-prem data center of the customer. But this is just to also see where exactly where is the ownership of those categories. Now let's look at the software view. So the software view, what is this all about? And also let's start from the left side. So we have here the end devices, the things. And these things, they are generating the data. So this is basically it. Of course, there are lots of, or like they're coming in the end, more intelligent things or intelligent sensors there, where they know if, for example, there is a race or suddenly there is, for example, a 200% raise of the temperature, and they will definitely send immediately, for example, a warning out. So there can be also intelligent sensors there. However, right now, basically depends on the use case, and it's still too costly sometimes for the customer to buy these sensing devices. It is right now very simple, and there are lots of proof of concepts out there where you place the sensors, and then actually the sensors are basically sending the data to an IoT appliance or to an edge broker. And this comes also here with the IoT appliance and with the routers. So basically what do they do? We have a low powered CPU there. They do data transformation. So connecting all those heterogeneous devices, connecting all those systems there, and do basic computing, basic data transformation, some data analytics, streaming data analytics. You can run your Python script, you can run your C++, C script, and so on, whatever SDK there is. You have, for example, from Microsoft, from AWS, from Google, you have also these IoT SDKs or IoT Edge SDKs, where you can deploy this software basically on those appliances. And this is in the end, you can run your software there. It is definitely sufficient for lots of use cases where you, in the end, send your data to a lot of IoT appliances. They get aggregated and then sent to the cloud. What is important here is definitely software and hardware management from both devices, because imagine you have a couple of hundreds or a couple of thousands IoT appliances or routers or gateways. So you definitely need to think as a consumer in the end, but then also as a programmer, how do you manage this code? Like, how can you manage your application as a software lifecycle there? And then also, how can you manage the hardware? So basically, this is important. It's usually, sometimes it's converged. Sometimes it is, depending on the hardware vendor, sometimes it is separated. But this is for the whole software lifecycle, definitely important to see, okay, how actually can I update my software, which is 1,000 kilometers away, or which is has a remote connectivity there. So basically, you need to definitely have this in mind. Also, containers. So why is it written here containers? Usually, and I will go into the demo later on about a bit, you run your software in containers there. So this is simple Docker containers, LXC containers. Sometimes you see KVM, so virtual machines there, but usually you have a container platform there where you can deploy your software in containers. On the other hand, like on the other, or on this side, cell tower and regional data center. So with the cell tower, and this is coming more and more, especially, and this is where this comment was definitely right, about 5G scenarios. So a lot of service providers are building right now these edge computing scenarios directly at the cell tower or directly at their edge. So what does it mean? So I think you have heard of Google Stadia, for example, with gaming. Video streaming, so that, for example, your Netflix TV show, for example, does not need to be streamed from the server of the US or from the server in Europe, but actually even closer to the data center or to the edge tower closest to your home. So this is basically a really nice scenario where a lot of cloud vendors as well, like Azure, like AWS, are going more and more to this bigger edge compute scenario where they are having containers, virtual machines running, and where you, like any service provider or like any provider of any service, can deploy their services or their compute power at the edge there. On the other side, or on the other, on the next category is the region data center, is basically very similar, however, not related to the cell tower, to this 5G scenario. It can be seen as a content delivery network, so more in this kind of section. However, you can have it basically as a distributed data center. So you have scalable edge service there, also with gaming, AI, video streaming, you name it, depending, of course, on the service tier. You have a high availability, so this is the reason, this is the main reason to have it, high availability, low latency, of course, and a lot of performance there. And here again, containers and virtual machines. So similar to the cell tower, so what will be run there, Kubernetes, for example, as the container orchestrator, and then different Docker containers, for example, for the edge scenarios, which will be in the end deployed there. Here as well, just end customer and managed service, just to have it here as well in the slide here. So against cell tower or from a software view is as well, and the region data center, this is basically from the service provider or the public cloud provider, or in the end the private cloud from the customer. In the end, from the other side, with the end customer and managed service, is again on the Think side, on the IoT appliances and the IoT gateway side. So I will stop again. Let's see if there are any questions from your side. Seems good. If not, definitely check it. You can definitely ask the questions, the Q&A in the end. So now I would like to go more into the router and gateways section there. So what you can see here, so router gateways, how does it look like? How can you deploy your software? How can you manage it? What kind of scenarios are there? And of course, the use cases. And there I would like to go more into, give you a picture of what kind of, or how does the hardware look like? And so basically, routers and gateways. So as you may know, Cisco, so we are providing network hardware as well as blade servers, rack servers as well. But this is just a kind of an overview of what you see there, that you have on an access point, on wireless access point, on a dedicated compute node, industrial compute here, on a switch, so on an industrial switch here as well, on an enterprise switch, on a classic IoT gateway with LTE connectivity, or on an enterprise router. So you have a lot of selection there where you can deploy your software, your containers on those devices. So this is basically, this is this section here, routers and gateways. We have a low powered, or like also sometimes not so low, but basically you can think of an x86 CPU there with some gigabyte of RAM, with SSD storage, where basically like classic data brokers, or in the end, simple Python script, for example, or like a Python software can run there. And this is basically the hardware view. And now let's check also from the software side, actually, what is there. So what you see here is, let's start with the bottom, the networking hardware. So the classic networking hardware there. You have as well USB interface and SSDs, various sensors, so accelerometer and so on. And then you have this operating system. So this is this iOS XE, where this is basically a Linux kernel, where you can run your applications there. So applications, what does it mean? So we call it this Cisco IOX app hosting, where you can deploy, like this is here in orange, can deploy your Docker containers, which can run on this networking hardware. The containers are, as you may know with Docker, connected with virtual interfaces directly to the kernel. So basically, you can say who can access those this application, what kind of IP address does this application have, and you can, in the end, control all of these this container runtime with either a web UI locally on the device, with a remote management tool on-prem, with a remote management tool in the cloud, or via APIs directly. So just for you as an overview, before that, the classic networking hardware or IoT hardware, we run here the operating system, and there on this, which is here in green, on this operating system, you can run your Docker containers there. And this is basically where I am also will show you how exactly this will be done. Create the Edge application. So this is basically the workflow. So if you don't know Docker, no worries. So this is pretty simple here. You have here the Docker file, so basically the recipe, what you want in your Docker image. So this is basically your goal. You want to have this Docker image, which is the container with your code. So you create this Docker file. You pull your repositories, so what libraries you need, what kind of Python libraries, for example, what kind of Linux-based system you want to have in your container. You put everything together, and you create with the Docker runtime, which is like on your laptop, for example, installed on your laptop, you create this Docker image. And when you create this Docker image, you can export it to a tar file. And this is basically then your app. This is basically your Edge application, what you can deploy, what you can connect. And you see this this package tower, this application as a single instance to the bigger picture. So basically, this is one piece of the code of your application. But of course, this will be just one part of your application. Another one sits in the cloud, for example. Another one can sit in your local data center. But depends, of course, on your software architecture. However, this would be one piece of software what can run on your hardware. And I would like to go now and more into detail here. So I will get now into an example here. So basically, let's open this one here. And I will make this a bit larger that you can see it. So basically, what you have here, or what's written here in this example is, I have this server.js script. And if I, in the end, show you the server.js script, is basically a JavaScript where you run a really simple server which will respond with hello world, and it will run on the port 8000. So the server will listen here, you will have the log entry there. So this is a really simple JavaScript here with Node.js, where you basically just have a server running. And how do you install it, or like how do you in the end create it or put this code on the network device or on the edge device? So you just do it with Docker. So in the end, I have also here, and let's see it here, this Docker file here. So if we go to, if you check the Docker file, it's a really short file actually. So these two lines here. And these two lines is basically the recipe. So what do you want to have in this, or like what do you want to have in your container? And this container, like this whole package, will be deployed. So at first we have this from Alpine. So it will be Alpine, is this Alpine Linux, so which is the container, or like the base the container image, like where is this container image from, what is the how will the container be built, with which Linux flavor, as you say. And from there, you pull a really like Alpine Linux. You can pull, of course, Ubuntu as well. Alpine, it has a really small footprint. So for this low-powered CPU devices, so I would definitely recommend go to Alpine. Or if Ubuntu is needed, of course, Ubuntu is also fine. Then you run this this Alpine Package Manager. So this is APK add. You update it, of course, like you pull the latest repositories there, and you install Node.js. So in the end, you just install this Node.js from the package manager from Alpine. And then you add this server.js, what I just showed you. There's this server.js. You add this server.js file to here in this root documentary of your container. So this root documentary is basically like a Linux tree. In the end, you say here expose. So expose means you expose the port 8000. So where you can definitely like access the server here. So you expose this specific port. And in the end, you have an entry port, entry point. And we do this with command, with the command one, where when you start this container, you will in the end do have this command running with Node and server.js. So you start basically this server.js script. And this is all this, the Docker file. Of course, there can be way more flavors. There can be way more commands there, but it's a pretty common and standard tool in order to get your software out there. So basically, what do I do now? So if you say it here, so I will remove the package tar file, and then basically it's a simple command. So I will say docker build, then I will say something there, so t for text, so or for title. So what is the title there? So we are Node.js. And then I say the Docker file is located in this folder here. I just make the dot there. And then I'm building my Docker image there. It is already, so I have it already built. So this is cached. So this is why it was really really fast in the end. So you can see here, you run the APK add, the Node.js, the add server.js. You expose the 8000 and so on. And then you actually have to have the server running there. When you would like to, so we can see here in Docker images, let's go to Docker images there. Sorry, this is a lot, but we have here, for example, we are Node.js. We have the latest, so like it's was created 2 months there, but here we have the Node.js there. And then it's super simple. So we do a Docker save. We say we are Node.js, and we save it to Node.js to tar, for example. And then we save it to a tar, so we export it, and then we see it here, the Node.js.tar file. And then what I do now, so basically I will show you now how I would check it, like port it on the container, and this will be done. So I did it already. I will share it now with the Road Machine. So basically this is the interface where you can have your this is the interface of the device, so of the on-box management, where you can see all your applications. And this is connected to my data center, so what I did before. Just to save, of course, time, I already exported it with package.1. I will install it now. So this is basically the same package.tav file what I already have. And when it's deployed, then I just need to activate it. And this is basically also very simple. I just do a port mapping there. I can also actually say another port here. So I have internal port and external port. So I can just say, no, I changed it. So I will now do the, for example, like port 6000. I want to reach my application now with port 6000. And then basically when I did all the port mapping, I say, okay. And then I activate the application. So it will be deployed in the RAM of the device there. So I see it's activated, it's ready to start, and then I basically start it. So in the end now, what can I do? I will check now if it worked, and I hope it worked. So I will just do, I think, the port 6000 there. This address is, of course, 1 second there. It's the 11, so let me just check, or maybe it was not good that I put the 6000, maybe it's already reserved. No, this should be fine. All right. Anyways, I will definitely check it. But actually, we can check in the log as well now why it did not work. Because maybe I did something. Yeah, maybe I did something with the expose that there is something wrong there. But basically, you can see here in the log file. So server is running at the port 8000. So then usually, like you can definitely see there that. This container is basically running. You can see the log entries there, and of course the health. So you can have a lot of health parameters you can put in there. You see the CPU usage there. And if you want, you have also the possibility of doing app configuration there. So this would be a really good move there to say, for example, that you want to have the port there. So port equals 6000, that it will recognize which port there is. Right. Cool. So looking also at the time a bit, I would just go a bit through the use cases, what kind of use cases there are. So a really classic use case would be to have an energy consumption there, to record the energy consumption of an industrial machine. Send it via this industry protocols Modbus TCP, for example, to Cisco Gateway, and there you run your MQTT broker. So basically, you will receive Modbus TCP files. You put it into a JSON data model. You can connect then or send this data via MQTT to your cloud, and you can control, for example, this specific gateway with the Cisco management tool. Another one would be here with in the edge with OPCOA data, where you have your OPCOA data model. You will provision it into the Cisco router, into your application there, and then you forward it, for example, to Azure. And another one would be, for example, this water distribution use case. So basically, where you have various Modbus protocols, where you have various other protocols, which are definitely needed by industry controllers, by industries IoT devices, and where you actually send your data to your network device, or where your edge data broker is basically hosted, and then you send the data here in this case to, for example, to the via cellular to the control center. And if there is any leak, for example, the leak will immediately detect it and will go directly to the control center, to the monitoring there. Cool. Last but not least, I'm so sorry that I went through this a bit fast here, but I would like to say here, so just also for you to see what is Cisco DevNet. So we are the developer focus community for Cisco. So if you would like to know more about it, so there is developer.cisco.com, our website, where you can see how can you interact with those devices, how can you deploy your Docker container on these IoT gateways, and then of course how like what kind of use cases there are and what in the end can you do there. So this would be a really cool place to start, and for that I say definitely thank you for listening, and I hope it was fun. And yeah, if you have any questions, please shoot in the Q&A. I'm checking right now if there are any questions.
I am also back just for a moral support of the silence of the web of the webinars. Yeah, let's see.
Right. So if you have any questions, definitely feel free to write it now. Feel free also to reach out to me, and of course to Viljana. But I see some people are typing, so yeah, like definitely, right? We will stay a bit one minute more on there a bit, so I'd like to see if there are any questions, and then definitely we can answer them.
Thanks for the great session. That's
awesome. Thank you.
That's a nice feedback. And let's see. Yeah, there was one more typing. I don't know if a question will come up. Meanwhile, maybe, so we don't keep... Ah, look, there is a question. Sorry, was not on the webinar from the beginning, but what kind of devices is deployed on?
Right, so no worries there. So basically, I can maybe a bit reshare here something. I will maybe go back to this slide here, to the hardware view. So in the end, what I was talking about here is IoT appliances and router gateways, or here in our Cisco way, the routers and the gateways, where you can deploy your Docker containers on those devices. So they are low-powered x86 or RM devices. So this is basically where we see this is basically the true edge, or where definitely a lot of use cases are, where you need at least some middleware on a software perspective and on the hardware perspective, some of these devices there. On the other side, cell tower and regional data center, this is more of the data center CPU, x86 CPU. And if you're talking about the Cisco devices, or if you're asking about these ones, so you can deploy on those devices your Docker containers or your software. And on Cisco Blade server, so this is basically a Blade server, you can run, of course, an ESXi, VMware, Hyper-V, and so on, of course, lots of other hypervisors, tier 1 hypervisors, for example. But all on all of this hardware, basically, you can deploy your Docker containers, your software on those devices. And of course, as I mentioned previously, it really depends there on the use case.
Thank you. We actually got meanwhile one more question. I'm just going to publish it here so everybody can see it. What is the difference between edge computing or commuting? I'm not sure if that's a mistake. And IoT, yeah. Are they the same?
Right. So in the end, I would say they are different. Like they mean something different, but they're very, very related to each other. So IoT is in the end this whole thing about connecting everything. Connecting in the end your freezer, connecting your TV, connecting your table, for example, whatever there is, whatever physically there is, you are connecting. And edge computing is in the end helping IoT to move forward and connecting those different devices closer to the edge. Because why would you want to connect those devices? Why would you want to connect those devices together? Usually you want to send all the data to the cloud and to have it basically in a nice dashboard visible, your current state, your monitoring status there. And edge computing helps you in the, as a middle layer between the cloud and between the sensor to move IoT forward.
Cool, I hope this is clear. There is another more logistical question. Is there going to be a recording on the session? Yes, we will have the recording on our Weird Developers channel on YouTube. And then another one, can you give some examples of AI in edge computing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really a cool question, and I think a lot of people are going there. The classic and what I see right now where we are working on as well as other companies is video recognition or image recognition. There basically you see, and this is like AI as like ML as part of an AI, so machine learning, where you can recognize who is actually there, if there is something happening, if the package system or if the packets, like for example in the DHL or Deutsche Post, for example, if the package is has the right size, has a bit of a smaller size, is maybe broken even, then this is a classic view where a camera is sensing it or recognizing and seeing if this box is damaged, and then immediately they need to analyze immediately the image if the data model is saying, hey, there is actually something missing, or there is, for example, there is a damage at the right corner there of this package. So this is where right now a lot of people, like with this video streaming, so IP cameras, and then of course connected there to either a dedicated compute node or directly at the camera already. So for example, in Cisco Meraki, we have this this example there where we run a Snapdragon RM CPU with a graphics unit directly on the camera. So we will do this hardware image recognition directly on the camera. So this is basically one really good example there. But then on some other examples there, I think it will still come. But right now we have in the end this image recognition there. If you talk about just about like classic machine learning with another really classic use case is predictive maintenance. So where you have the machine, it is operating normally, but then you see there are some factors there. For example, gradiently or like really over 1 year, for example, or even over 1 or 2 weeks, this value, this specific machine value, is getting lower, lower, lower. And this is basically an indicator, or can be an indicator, that the machine will fail within the next month. And this is where machine learning is also coming more and more into the game of where you can detect with predictive maintenance when a machine will fail or not. So this would be two examples which are definitely real and already deployed right now.
And I guess somehow a follow-up question to one of your answers. So this means that we will be also able to move some OSS and network monitoring provisioning functions to Edge. I mean, is there enough power there?
Yeah, this depends on the use case. Again, this is, I would say yes and no. So definitely there is a yes. So there would be enough power there to do your basic computing, to do your basic IoT analytics there. Also network monitoring, of course, with iPerf, with Wireshark, and so on, what you can deploy directly on your network device. So yes, definitely. But if you want to do, of course, more powerful data analytics, big data analytics, like a really big data set, then I would say no. There is definitely not enough power there, or not enough computing power, storage, RAM, whatever. So I would say no. So this depends there.
Okay, and from the same person, another, if my company have a Docker-based product which does predictive maintenance for cable device spectrum analysis, so small function, should we consider deployment? Functions are low-level I'm not sure. SNMP
Level
flows.
SNMP flows, yeah.
Yeah.
I would definitely say so. It's a small function. I would say you can if it's just a small function and if it's it does not need to go to your cloud or to your data center for a small function or for anything related. So depends again. Sorry about your architecture, but I would say if it can run it doesn't need a lot of compute power. Your functions or basically your or if there are SNMP traps, for example, what you are analyzing, then you can definitely do this directly on the switch in your Docker container there. You can just run it there. Basically see it like this. It is another IP address in the network where you can send something in. So think about this as a service-oriented approach where you send in at this specific IP address, your function or your data, and then you get the output back. And the IP address or behind the IP address is nothing more than the software or the Docker container running somewhere. And this somewhere is on your network device. So this is, I would say definitely try it out on developer.cisco.com. We have some really cool learning labs there. We have also some sandboxes where you can try your hardware out. So this is, I would say this is possible.
Thank you. And the one last question from Ahmad. Do you recommend any references we can use to be familiar with edge computing?
Right. So basically, I would say look on the website from on our website with Cisco. So we have really lots of references there. For example, this water consumption or water monitoring. This is a real use case what we deployed in the US. We have then, for example, in Austria as well, and then also in the US roadways. So where like next to the roadways, we do a lot of edge computing where we are gathering data from the sensors and then aggregating the data and sending only the relevant data, of course, with a smaller footprint, then basically to the data lake or like to where the data will be stored. And then I would say also like smart city use cases, oil and gas use cases. So we have in every industry right now. So there are lots of use cases I can think of. I would say check out the on our website. So Cisco white papers usually or case studies. This is the keyword. So Cisco case studies edge computing. I would say there are tons of public information as well for you. Maybe not the detailed, but at least to get you started on how we do it, how it works.
Thank you. And cool. I guess with this, we are closing the question section of this session today. Just two more things from us, from my side. Thank you first, Florian, for the engaging presentation. I think people are starting to write thank you as well in the comments. So I much appreciate it. And I hope we'll have you sometime soon again with us.